And just a few things I want to say, I'm delighted to have the opportunity to be here, to tell you what I see from the places I've been and where I am now. I get a pretty good view of a lot of things. And I remember, Aaron, you mentioned that life science piece. I think that was in 2005, or was it about then? I really didn't know what life sciences were. And it seems to me we were just really getting started. But that was an act. It was so good. It had the Life Science Act in it, provided for avenues in life science and also research and several other things. And it was so good, everybody knew it was going to pass. So everybody in the legislature put every little tidbit that they wanted on there. And I mean, that was stuff that was related to nothing having to do with life sciences or anything else. Well, one of them was dealt with curriculum at various schools, pay scales for professors, and there was one about a cooking school in Charleston that was to be set up. And I remember arguing the case. It was said to be unconstitutional because you're not only supposed to have one subject in a case, in a bill that passes, and this had stuff all over the place. The Chief Justice, Jean Toe, called it the kitchen sink bill. And she ended up saying it's the most unconstitutional thing she'd ever seen, or something like that. You imagine the fun we had watching the lawyers trying to defend the thing, arguing how a cooking school in cooking chickens in Charleston was related to cloning chickens at the research university. So we're trying to make that connection is impossible. But we won that case, and we won a lot of other things in South Carolina. I guess I can't speak for all the other states other than I know it's the South. It's the Southeast that's going up. There's no doubt about it. And I've seen studies. I know of all sorts of research that's been done. And you can just look at where people are going. People vote with their feet. And they're leaving the big cities. They're leaving Chicago. They're leaving New York. Leaving Philadelphia. They're leaving the big cities. And where are they coming? They're coming to the sunny South. The southeastern states are where the action is going to be for the foreseeable future. And we in South Carolina are better positioned to be on top of that and to take advantage of that than any other state. And I'll tell you why I say that. And I think everybody here has a story they could tell that would add to this story. But we have, over the years, we have built the platform and have the assets, all that we need, more than any other state, that supports this knowledge-based economy that's coming. I say it again, nobody else has what we have. The other states have a lot of good things, but none of them have all that is necessary to provide the platform and the opportunity for the life sciences, for example, as well as many other things. The more sophisticated, the more brain power that is involved, this is the place to do it, right here. And a lot of it involves communication, collaboration, and cooperation. We in South Carolina have been able to break down the barriers. Of course, we most of us related to each other in one way or another. I remember what Lindsey Graham said when he started off as a young lawyer. He'd have people come to him and say, well, we want to know that if we got married in South Carolina and divorced in Georgia, are we still cousins? Those kind of relationships, remember, relationships open the doors. They open the door better than a good resume. And we, people in this state, know each other so well and related to so many. Nobody is more than one or two phone calls away from somebody who has the answer to the question that they have. But we have all of the assets that we need. One, we got water, is Knox White, and Mayor Greenville. Greenville is just thriving more than it has in 30 or 40 years. It's something to see. But he said the reason they do it is because they're emphasizing trees and water. That's something they don't have in a lot of states. But we have abundant trees and water. I flew in a plane to come down here. There are trees all over the place. I mean, they're pretty. It's green. And during the hurricane, going up and down the coast, looking at the results of the hurricane, if you haven't had an opportunity to fly over the low country or fly over our coast and look at it, you're really missing something. We don't realize how lucky we are to have what we have. The big And speaking of water, y'all remember Senator John McCain, he used to joke that in Arizona, the trees chase the dogs out there. But we don't have that problem. We don't have that problem. So what do we have? And I'm thinking of an agricultural base that leads to agricultural products being involved in nutritious things for health. I'm thinking of the pharma, of the drug, that sort of industry, as well as the health IT. And the health, if we can get a good grip on telemedicine, and I think we've got a good start here in the state, we can really revolutionize things. Because we got to get out to the people. Everybody can't go to the hospital, they can't even go to the emergency room. We're all looking for ways to reduce those costs and make the people healthier. Well, of course, the answer to it, part of it, is to go after where they are and keep them from getting sick to begin with. Teach them how they ought to live. Break bad habits, start new habits. A lot of people just don't understand, and they need to learn, but they need to have access where they are to help. And a lot of people in this state and all others cannot leave work for a day to go to the hospital or go to the doctor, because somebody's going to have to take them, somebody's got to watch the children, somebody's got to do this. You have to shut down the whole community almost to take someone into the doctor. So we've got to take the doctors and the nurses. Have y'all been in the Rite Aid or CVS, these places where they had these minute clinics? I know there are people that are looking to make little kiosks that they can put in. They can put them anywhere. Put them in grocery stores, put them in pharmacies where you can go sit down, punch a button, and you can access the doctor right there, and you can take your temperature, and you can just stick it on yourself and take your blood pressure. All that right there and costs very little, and you have complete access to a nurse or doctor right there. And in these clinics they have, mini clinics they call it at CVS, they have nurses right there. Yes, I went to one the other day just to be there when they opened it up. It looked just like every doctor's office I've ever been in, except it wasn't a doctor. It was one on call. So those are the kind of things that with the advent of the communication that we have now, there's no excuse, there's no reason why we don't break down those barriers and take it right straight to the people so they can get it on their phone if they have one. If they don't have one, get it some other way, go to the grocery store and there'll be a kiosk. But the answer, I think, is communication, as I said, collaboration and cooperation. A cute story about communication, y'all may have heard it, about the young couple that did not communicate. Rare, they just didn't talk much. They were taciturn. That's a big word. They didn't talk much. So what did they do? They looked at each other and said, I love you, baby. I love you. You want to get married? Mm-hmm. So they got married. Moved into a little house. Still didn't talk much. A couple of weeks later, old mom-in-law moved in with them. Well, they didn't talk about that much either. Finally, about a month later, the young groom says, baby, don't you think it's about time we find your mama someplace else to live? She said, my mama, I thought she was your mama. Not a communicator. But I see Harris Pastine sitting down there and Bill Kirkland, where'd they go? Up in Anderson the other day, Jim Clements, the president of Clemson, was there. I know David Cole here or is close by somewhere. But we've got three major research universities that communicate, and collaborate, and cooperate. You don't find that in other places. Not only does everybody not have three research universities, three real powerful research universities, but these work together and they collaborate with private companies. And it's on vivid display at the corner of Blossom and Assembly Street in Columbia, where you have the IBM National Data Analytics headquarters right there. Also, Siemens just gave $600 and something million worth of top-of-the-line software, analytical software. The Watson computer there, I was talking to someone about Watson and data analytics and how they can predict when a camshaft or a spark plug or a tire or something is going to run it to wear out on an automobile so you can fix it before you need to and miss the downtime. Can you imagine what that would do to a variety of industries across the board? And I said, well, wouldn't it be nice if we could do that with the human body? And the man said, well, come to think of that. See, we did a study on cancer, and we had a group of medical professionals analyzing cancer cases to determine the course, the future course. And we also put that same information into, I think it was Watson, and the computer beat the medical experts by 30. they make surgical instruments for things like fixing this orthopedic type stuff, where it used to be you go in the hospital and they'd have to cut you open and you'd be in there for days while they're working on a torn meniscus or whatever. Well, and now they do that, you go in and they have a little teeny little thing they put in there and fix it, and you leave with a Band-Aid on that afternoon. Well, that company started in 1981 in either Michigan or Minnesota, and then moved down. Big headquarters is in Florida, but they just opened up in Anderson, South Carolina. Why'd they do that? Well, I asked. And it was because of this. It's because of the unique things that this state provides. That is this. They have a fantastic technical college there. And the people that will be working in that company, this is sophisticated, high-paying work, can be trained, many of them, in that technical college system. Now, we started ours back in 1961. You know, remember, Senator, then Governor Fritz Hollings was one of the leaders in the United States, and seeing that this was the way we needed to go, towards high sophisticated training and brain power, and we started our technical college system in 1961. Some states are trying to start it now. Some started a few years ago, and then they sort of drifted over into trying to be community colleges and work their way up somehow to being like a four-year college and drifted away from the mission. And as a result, and also as a result of the fact that in our culture, everyone wants to be successful, and we've been urging people to go to a four-year school. There are plenty of people that want to go to a four-year school and get that bachelor's degree, a master's degree, a PhD, or something else. But also there are a lot of people that like to go on and work with their brains and their hands. And that's the kind of jobs that are all over the place right now in South Carolina, in Europe, all over the rest of the states. And they tell me, the leaders of these big companies that I've been able to speak to the last 3 years, they can't find enough people to fill those jobs. We've got a deficit of about 60,000 people right now. First time in South Carolina's history, we have 60,000 jobs looking for people instead of people looking for jobs. But they can be trained, they can learn, they can educate in higher education in the technical college system. And it is, as I say, high-paying, good work. $75,000 for a welder, $100,000 with a two-year associate degree from the technical school, you can get a job, $75,000 a year out walking out the door as a welder. And if you get your nuclear welding certificate, that's $100,000 or so a year. But all sorts of high-tech skill things working in these plants that I'm speaking of. So we have that technical college system. And we will also, we have a part of our technical college system where we will send people from the technical colleges to another country to look at the plants there, look at the companies, understand the culture and the attitudes, and also what kind of training is necessary to run these very sophisticated machines in these big plants, robotics and all that. And we will set up a curriculum back here to train out people here to go in to learn how to do that kind of work when those companies get here. We're the only state in the United States that does that. And the collaboration between the research universities, the four-year schools, the technical colleges is something that's off the scale. We have that. Nobody else has that. So what else do we have? Just down the street, we have one of the best ports in the whole country. It is growing leaps and bounds. In a few years, that and the port of New York, New Jersey will be the dominant ports on the Atlantic coast. How do you spell port? M-O-N-E-Y. That's how you spell port. And it's coming. And not only do we have a deep water port that's getting deeper, but it's going deeper, and we'll be able to handle those big ships that we call them post-Panamax after they've expanded the Panama Canal. The bigger ships from the Pacific can now come through Panama and come up the Atlantic coast. So they're coming here. Every now and then you see one in the port right now because they can get in at high tide. They just can't get out at low tide. And ours is wide enough to where you can have two of them going in and out at a time. You can't do that in Savannah. Can't do that in most other places. But that port is something. But in addition to that, it's got the fastest turnaround time, by the way, in the United States. Something like 26 minutes for unloading or loading something on one of those ships in Los Angeles. It's about 2.5 hours. And they're working over there. It's a great, great port. But also, our port has two inland ports, one under construction and one already working. And the one is working now is the Norfolk Southern line, runs from Charleston up through, across 85, through Greer and on to other ports. What that means is that truckers coming in I-85 can put a load or pick up a load there that'll either go to Charleston or it's come up from Charleston on the train that goes back and forth every day. And that saves 400 and something miles. That saves 400 and something miles worth of time and money. And we're getting ready to open one up in Greer, in Dillon, which crosses 95. No other state has got that. So all this logistical, those sort of computations are being made by companies when they want to come here. And as I said, if you fly over the state and you look at the green, you look at the water, it's really something. And you don't see that. No other state has all of what we have. No other state has all these things that are required for the kind of advancement, the kind of industry, the kind of sophisticated movement that you are here talking about today. So this is the place to be. And my view is that there's not another state that can catch us. We're ahead of them, and I think they all realize that from the places I go and the people I talk to. They understand that. So my job is to, in this position, is to be sure we don't mess it up. And that means keep the taxes low, keep the regulations reasonable, keep people safe. We have to have some new ideas for educating children, a lot of things that we need to do. But as far as the basic platform on which to work, we have got it. We have got things that nobody else has. So the future is bright, and particularly for this kind of industry. This is brain power. This is taking care of the human body. And what could be more important than that? Healthy people can do a lot of things. And I think it is a most exciting to see all of these people gathered here to discuss this and the possibilities for the future. I learned a long time ago that the only shame is low aim. I'd rather aim high and fail than aim low and succeed. And I also have learned over the years that there's no power in a small idea. And I'll finish up by quoting Harris Pastides and Jim Barker, who's the president up at Clemson. Harris is wiggling in his seat, wondering what I'm going to say. But they both said the same thing, using slightly different words, and that is, we don't want to hear anymore that South Carolina is a small, poor state and we can't do anything, because it is not true. There's no limit to what this state can do if we just aim high and work hard and dream big. Bill Gates said that only his company's only asset was imagination. And so I believe that, and I've seen it work in people's lives. So I thank y'all for being here and appreciate it very much.